3, 2, 1.
Okay.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to this special MOA webinar. I'm here with Dr. Parag Sancheti, President of Maharashtra Orthopaedic Association, and Dr. Shiva Shankar. So let's begin with Dr. Sancheti talking about MOA webinars, and go ahead, sir.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you very much, Dr. Ashok Sham, for setting this up. So this is again one of the MOA webinars, which is an initiative of the MOA research cell, which was set up about 8 weeks ago. I think these MOA webinars are picking up. This is fifth in the series, and we've had some interesting MOA webinars in the past. Today we have with us none other than our dynamic past president of MOA, Dr. Shiv Shankar, who will be sharing with us his huge experience in proximal femoral nailing. The topic which he's going to speak to us on today is how to avoid common mistakes while doing the proximal femoral nail. So Shiva, we welcome you to this MOA webinar series, and we thank you for joining in. As you know, he's been the past president of MOA and is also the vice presidential candidate for the forthcoming IO elections. So Shiva, welcome to this webinar. And before Dr. Shiv Shankar takes over, I would like to welcome all of you to this MOA webinar and want to request you to register for the forthcoming MOA Con meeting, which is in Pune from 1st to 4th of November at the JW Marriott. This is the 35th annual meeting of the MOA Con. And this program has been planned in detail by the team Pune, who's going to host the MOA Con this year. So I welcome all of you for the MOA Con and request you to register for this meeting in case you haven't. So with this few introductory words, I now hand over to Dr. Shiv Shankar to tell us more about how to avoid common mistakes in proximal femoral nailing. Over to Dr. Shiv Shankar.
Thank you, sir. Welcome, Shiv Shankar, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Parag Sancheti, sir, President of Maharashtra Orthopaedic Association, as well as Dr. Ashok Sham, sir, who has been the main brain behind this Ortho TV Live. And this is the second time I am here again on this Ortho TV in this 2 months' time. Coming to my topic, I've been doing PFN for the past 20 odd years, and I have done a lot of mistakes, and I have learned from my own mistakes, and many people share their WhatsApp pictures with me, and analyzing those, I have compiled this short talk on how to avoid common mistakes. And when he shared the picture, yeah, this is working perfectly now. Thank you, Sham. This is the picture he shared me, and since this was the first case he has done, I initially said, done beautifully, because I know that the first few cases are very difficult for anybody to do. But subsequently, I analyzed them. I said, there is a varus in the fracture site that should be avoided. This is where the beak of the neck is entered into the distal fragment. Then superior opening of the fracture site is there, and that has led to the varus actually. You can see that nail has been shoveled at the fracture site, and also there is slightly longer screws that I will be analyzing later on. So because of the varus, the neck becomes horizontal and the screw automatically becomes slightly longer. Then superior screw is comparatively longer. It has gone almost subchondral. Normally, this is the line at which the superior screw should stop, so that both the screw can take the load simultaneously. So this superior screw longer will cause the problem of either the superior screw breaking or the Z effect. Then peak of the proximal fragment entering into the distal medullary canal. Many a time, we all orthopedic surgeons who have been doing DHS feel that a Diamond Houston type of osteotomy, where the peak of the proximal fragment entering into the distal fragment, is a stable reduction, but that is a very wrong notion. In an intramedullary implant, if your peak is inside, that indicates that it is varus. You should never accept a varus like this. So these are some of the points which we could make out in the immediate post-operative X-ray. Another case, you can see that the patient has been operated and the distal fragment has been fixed in internal rotation because that was the position in which the patient, the reduction was obtained by the surgeon. So without realizing that the distal, the limb is in internal rotation, the distal locking has been done. So this patient had to be treated with removing of the distal locking screw and again doing a another locking. One more X-ray picture shared again on a WhatsApp group. This surgeon said that the distal part of the long femoral nail, which he used for a plain subtrochanteric fracture, was abutting against the distal cortex, and he had a lot of trouble in inserting the nail, and he ended up in creating a small crack at the distal interlocking hole side. That's what he told me on WhatsApp picture. After seeing this picture, I asked him to send me a proper AP and lateral picture of the thigh, and I predicted that this is probably a wrong side nail being used. You can see that you have used the opposite side nail, hence the instead of nail curvature matching the femoral bow, it has actually caused wrong thing. So this, instead of keeping the curvature anteriorly along with the femoral bow, he has kept it posteriorly, so the distal part of the nail was abutting. Finally, he treated this fracture by removing of the nail, and re-nailing was done. Unfortunately, you can see that he ended up having a complete fracture of the distal fragment in this re-surgery. So these are all iatrogenic problems just because of wrong side nail was used in this case. So distal femoral fractures normally goes into hyperextension. So this has to be tackled properly. This is a segmental femoral fracture. And this is what I'm telling. The first slide shows the distal fragment going into hyperextension. So in such cases, what we have to do is, again, in this segmental fracture also, you can see that it has gone in hyperextension. I'm trying to lift that with a Skinman pin, getting the alignment right, then passing the nail and the guide wire very anteriorly and getting the reduction properly without having any recurvatum deformity. This is very, very useful, especially if you are operating these fractures, especially distal femoral fractures on an orthopedic table. So this is the final X-ray in the same patient, which he did subsequently extremely well. Another case came last year to me for implant removal. This nailing was done about 20 years back here only in Sholapur at some place. And you can see that we are encircled. The nail, again, a wrong side nail has been used. It's not the wrong side nail because this is a universal nail. Instead of rotating the nail along with the femoral curvature, it has been put in reverse fashion. And on the right side, after the implant has been removed, a dead lateral picture of the femur shows that the anterior bow has been totally lost and the femur has become straight because of this mismatch of the nail within the bone. Friends, newer technique has a learning curve. So we have to learn the technique properly, and by learning the technique properly, we can minimize the complications. And unfortunately, interlocking nailing has a long learning curve, and we have to be used to seeing the picture on a CM picture and operate on a patient. That is a little difficult thing to do simultaneously, analyzing the fracture and displacement. This is a very busy slide, but I call them all of them as some avoidable complications or avoidable mistakes, like incomplete reduction or fixation and distraction, incomplete length of the screws, incorrect insertion of the femoral neck fractures, problems with the distal nail locking, fracture of the lateral wall of the greater trochanter during insertion of the nail, lateral protrusion of the screw causing thigh pain, femoral shaft fracture at the nail tip, intra-articular migration of the screws, anterior thigh pain. There are so many. I have seen many, many, many number of complications, and it is very difficult to describe all of them. But if you are doing nailing regularly, it's better to have your own set, because with your own set, you know all the instruments properly and you will be knowing which one to be used when. And with a loaner set, many of the time, some of the instruments are missing. They might be very, very useful and critical for the surgery. And those instruments, if they're bad, that causes frustration during surgery to operate on these patients. So it's better to have your own set and have knowing the instruments and implant by your whole beer. You should know all the instruments and implant properly before carrying out this surgery. some of the important things for any intramedial nail is reduction. The anterior reduction and the medial reduction. They are the foremost thing. Implant is just a tool in your hand. You can use any of the nails available in the market and you can get beautiful result out of them if you know the technique properly of getting the reduction properly. So reduction is very, very important. Coming to the screw position, the next screw has to be in the AP picker, central to inferior. If it is a single screw system or if it is a two screw system like PFN, it has to be facing the calcar. The cervical screw should be as inferior as possible so that the superior screw has more place to be placed in the neck properly. In the lateral picture, it has to be central or slightly posterior because that is the part where the bone is very strong. The nail at the entry site should be outside the cortex. At the piriformis fossa or medial to the piriformis fossa where the nail enters, nail has to be outside. If the nail tip is inside the neck, then it can toggle and can cause displacement of the nail and displacement of the fracture. So if the system you are using is not having an end cap, then it's better to leave the nail longer outside. And if the system you have different sizes end caps, always try to use an end cap, either 5 millimeter or 0 millimeter, 10 millimeter, whichever one which causes the nail to be slightly outside at the entry side. Then the screw should be subchondral. If you are using a single system, if the screw is in the AP in the center of the neck, then the tip apex distance will be less. But if you are using a two screw system like PFN, the screw will be inferior in the neck, the cervical screw. So it's better to measure the subchondral distance from the articular surface. It has to be within less than 10 millimeter from the articular surface. And another thing is, if you are using a PFN A or a Halifax nail or a gamma nail, the number 5 marked here, the screw has to be slightly outside the bone by about 3 to 5 millimeter. If the screw is inside the medullary canal, then the screw cannot back out. Some of the time, the hole in the bone will mismatch with the screw to come out and jamming of the screw happens within the hole. So to prevent that, it's better to keep the screw slightly outside in this fashion. I will show a reduction properly how to do. This is an elderly lady of 75 years old. The fracture is already 2 weeks old and you can see the top x-ray that the neck was not reduced properly in lateral picture. So with a Steenman pin, I have manipulated, got the reduction, fixed with 2 KVS, then I have adducted and made an entry in this case. So this is the final picture of the same patient. On the right corner, you can see I am trying to insert an end cap. If the nail is inside the bone, the nail can toggle. So that's why we have to extend this in length of the nail by inserting an end cap. That is the reason why I showed this slide here. This patient had a very bad posterior cortex where I have marked the circle. You can see that there is hardly any bone. But you can see that the patient is walking so comfortably and the second post-operative day just because of the good session I have got, I'm able to ask the patient to walk on this implant. This is 1 month post-operative x-ray showing the position of the implants remaining the same position like the immediate post-operative x-ray. This is the 3 months follow-up picture where it shows formation of the bone posteriorly. The posterior cortex was totally absent in the immediate post-operative x-ray as well as in the intraoperative pictures. You can see that as per the Wolf law, bone forms where it is required and it gets resolved where it is not required. Here, around the nail, posteriorly, the bone has formed. This is the picture of the same lady at 8 months. Beautifully, the fracture has united and the patient is doing extremely very well. This is an example. You can see that the tip of the nail was buried inside the medullary canal. That has caused the distal fragment to move. It's like a DHS moving. The shaft of the parent plate of the DHS slides in a high subprochanteric fracture or the lateral wall fracture. Similarly, even a nail can also move more medially inside the medullary canal if the nail tip is not outside in the at the entry side. That is one of the reason why I have been insisting that the nail has to be slightly outside at the entry side. Friends, the foremost commonest mistake I see is the varus reduction. This varus reduction is mainly due to position of the patient, and especially if the patient is hefty, then this becomes much more problematic. Second cause is entry side problem, and I will discuss them in detail subsequently. The second problem I normally encounter when I see an X-ray is inability to pass both the screws. The surgeon passes only one of the neck screw and is unable to pass the derotational screw. Hence, he just inserts one of the screw and comes out of the surgery. This is due to a varus happening, is unable to pass the second screw properly. This happened to me way back about 15 to 20 years back, but in the last 15 years, it has never happened. Even in Indian implant, I have been able to put two screws properly. If the main cervical screw is very inferior, missing the calcar, and it is in the inferior part of the head, then the superior screw can be passed in the center or slightly superior to the center in the AP picture. This is one of the reasons why passing the difficulty in passing the second screw has been advantageously taken by some of the companies, and they have come out with single screw system. I will discuss about them also in due course of time. So difficulty in passing both the screws is the second problem. Third commonest problem, what we see is the lateralization of the shaft with altered biomechanics. Patient will be unable to walk because the fracture has united, but the shaft has become lateralized, and that is the reason why the patient is unable to walk. This is an example. You can see that though there is a pubic symphysis diastasis in this patient, that we'll not consider at this stage. But you can see that the neck of the operative side has become longer. Because the neck has become longer, though it is an intratrochanteric fracture has united, but the neck, the shaft has gone laterally and the lever arm of the hip is increased. So normally, if you draw a line from the outermost cortex or the outermost part of the pelvis, it grazes the tip of the trochanter or the outermost part of the trochanter. Whereas on the operative side, you can see that it's going at the nail entry side, it is going almost 1 inch of the trochanter is outside this line. Next commonest problem I encounter is long screws. If you are using screws of over 100 millimeter in length, especially in people or patient less than 6 feet tall, then there is something wrong. Majority of the reason is it is traction not released properly. To get a good traction, we apply traction on table, and unfortunately we forget to release this traction, and because of this traction, the neck, the fracture gets distracted and the neck length appears longer, and we try to end up using longer screw. As you can see in this case, a longer screw has been used. So if you are using a screw which is more than 100 millimeter, it's always better to confirm that really the patient is very, very tall. And you can see the opposite side hip also in the X-rays, and also confirm that you have released the traction properly and compacted the fracture properly. So these are some of the reasons for using a long neck. Friends, longer screws can lead to Z effect. I have talked in the last webinar about the Z effect and how to avoid. So I'm not going to the details of the Z effect here. But the reason why the Z effect happens is once this longer screw, the traction is released, the patient starts walking. Both the screws comes out of the lateral cortex at the entry site of the screws, and they start rocking in and out, and one of the screw tries to go in and one of them comes out, that will cause the Z effect. You can see this webinar in the archives of the same site, or also on my YouTube I have posted this video of how to avoid Z effect. I'll just recapitulate the steps of surgery quickly. This is a crack fracture, undisplaced fracture, but even then I fix them with two KYs anteriorly before making an entry. By fixing these two KYs anteriorly, when I make an entry with the reamer after putting the guide pin, the fracture will not open superiorly. Otherwise, a undisplaced fracture when you are putting a 15 or 16 millimeter reamer of the instrument, then it gradually opens, leading to varus. That's why always fix these fractures with two KVS, which are placed very anteriorly. Other advantage of fixing this fracture with two KVS are you can adduct the fracture. Once you can adduct the fracture, your entry site becomes very, very easy, especially in obese patients. So even if the fracture is reduced well in adduction, always try to fix the fracture before passing this reamer and then the nail. When you, after passing the nail, before you pass the guide wire, always make a hole in the lateral cortex at the entry site of the guide wire with a awl which comes with the set or with the drill which comes with the set. Because these guide wires are not made for drilling. These guide wires are, if you use for drilling the lateral cortex, they bend and go haywire. Some of the time they totally bend, they go anterior, even posteriorly behind the femur, and they entirely miss the hole. So it's always better to make a hole in the lateral cortex before we pass these guide wires. Normally, because the trabecular pattern in the femur, the inferior guide wire slightly bends upwards and the superior guide wire slightly bends downwards. So don't keep on changing this guide wire. It always goes in the same position because that's the path of least resistance. So I will answer in subsequent slides how to tackle these guide wires problem subsequently. And when you are passing the screws, always pass the superior derotation screw, because that word indicates that it's a derotation screw. When you pass the cervical screw, it has to act as a derotation screw. So always pass the superior. By passing the superior screw, you will get an idea also about the inferior cervical screw, which is very, very important. So you can, without changing or changing to different sizes of lengths of screw, you can use the correct size screw and pass it properly. So after passing both the screws, you have to judiciously compress the fracture after releasing the distal traction, and then you should do the distal locking. I am a fan of dynamic locking, and I may try to do dynamic locking in all these cases, but there are few people who also do static locking, and they also do equally get good results. Coming to the topic, entry site getting lateralized causing the varus. So this is the commonest problem. The entry site for a PFN is tip of the trochanter. Here is an X-ray which I have only operated sometime in 2009. You can see that I have taken the entry at the tip of the trochanter, but the bone is very weak on the outer side, or if there might be fracture on the outer aspect. So when you try to ream, your reamer gets reaming more on the outer side rather than and less on the inner thicker bone. So your reamer becomes lateralized, as you can see in this same patient. So this is the commonest problem we face. So I normally advocate in such cases, it's better to go medial to the tip of the trochanter or even from the piriformis fossa. How this entry gets lateralized? This is the tip of the trochanter entry, a proper entry for a PFN. But when you're reaming, the lateral cortex gets reamed, and the lateral cortex becomes weaker and weaker and becomes getting reamed more and more, and the hole or the entry site gets lateralized in this fashion. So this is how a normal PFN, the cervical screw or the inferior screw will be inferior in the head, neck as well as in the head part. But when the hole or the entry site gets lateralized, as you can see in this picture, when this gets lateralized, the screw which is inferior in the neck will go to the central part of the head or even in the superior part of the head. This is one of the reasons why your screw position will not be proper, because of the entry site getting lateralized. So always go for an entry which is medial to the tip of the trochanter and or even through the piriformis fossa, to avoid this problem of the nail going laterally and the screw not coming inferiorly, both in head and neck as well as in the neck as well as in the head. By chance, if we are done, what we can do is a different thing, but how we can avoid it? Here you can see that yellow marking has been done, where I am pushing with my left hand the reamer more medially, so that I will be reaming more the inner side cortex rather than the outer cortex. Here in this case, what we did was we nibbled out a piece of the bone medial to the entry site, and then we reamed with the centering awl again and passed the nail much more medially. So that's the reason why nowadays I always advocate it's better to go through the piriformis fossa and not have any problem. If you go through the piriformis fossa, majority of the problems are solved. Unfortunately, nobody advocates the piriformis fossa because there is an article which talks about if the entry at the piriformis fossa is done by more than 13 millimeter, there is chances of the circumflex femoral artery getting damaged, which might cause damage to the head of the femur. But friends, have seen so many cases, I'm yet to come across a case where a damage has caused a AVN in the femoral head, especially in an adult. The second problem, what we normally see is passing the nails through the fracture site. Friends, in which fracture we pass an implant through the fracture site? Why we want, just because there is an intertrochanteric fracture, we want to shovel the nail through the fracture site? This implant also requires a space. This implant is 15 to 16 millimeter in diameter proximally. You have to make a place for this nail. So you have to ream properly the proximal part of the femur. Without reaming properly, if you shovel the nail at the fracture site, it normally causes, it works as a spacer, and that's one of the causes why the neck, head and neck gets displaced medially and the head and neck goes into varus, as you can see in this picture. Here in this picture on the left, you can see that through the fracture site, the surgeon has pushed the reamer. Since there is no counteraction for the reamer to ream the proximal canal, both the head and neck fragment and the shaft fragment get separated widely and make space for the reamer to go inside without reaming any of the bone. That's another problem which should be totally avoided. Normally, when we fix a fracture on an orthopedic table, once we get a good reduction in this fashion, abduction and external rotation, we normally get a good reduction. And on adduction, what happens is the perineal post touches against the thigh, and you don't get more adduction than about 20 to 30 degrees in this patient. If you try to adduct more than this, the fracture opens superiorly in this fashion. So because of the adduction, the surgeon trying to adduct, making the entry site prominent for him to pass the nail, this adduction will cause superior opening even in a crack fracture. And this is one of the reason why the fracture goes into varus. This widening of the proximal or the entry site becomes, and when you pass the nail will go into the medullary canal. And if you lock in that same position, the head and neck is in varus. You can see that the superiorly the fracture has opened up, and that will lead to varus. That's another thing which you can see in the similar X-ray here. The fracture has gone into varus. Sometimes the surgeon realizes the mistake and he abducts. He realizes that there is a varus of the head and neck, so he tries to get the abduction back. So he abducts the limb. By this abduction, fracture also opens up inferiorly. Earlier, the fracture had opened up only superiorly. Now the fracture opens up inferiorly also. Though the head and neck angle or the neck shaft angle will be proper, but this fracture has gone into distraction and the implant is acting as a spacer, and the neck screw used will be longer in size. This is what is happening in this case. The lateralization of the shaft and the neck of the shaft has become longer in size only because of the implant, which is the surgeon initially abducted the limb which caused opening superiorly, then he abducted the limb which caused inferior opening also, causing the lateralization of the shaft. So this should be also avoided. So this is the same patient where you can see that the shaft has become, the neck length has become longer, and this can be measured from the center of the head. The line on the right side is longer than on the line on the left side. The most important way to measure is normally that greater trochanter, the outermost part of the greater trochanter lies within the pelvis. Means if you draw a line from the outermost part of the pelvis and drop it down to the ground, it grazes through the outermost cortex of trochanter. But on the right side, you can see that it's far, far outside than this. So that is the one which causes biomechanics of the hip. Though the fracture is united, the biomechanics of the hips have been totally lost, and this patient will be having very difficulty in walking because more power is required, because the trochanter and the tip of the trochanter is very laterally placed and the lever arm of the abductor mechanisms are totally lost, and this patient will be having very difficulty in walking. Newer implant doesn't mean that they can solve the problem. That's why I said that implants are just a tool in our hands. We should know how to use them properly. Here is an example. A PFN A2 has been used. Again, a lateralization of the shaft has been done. You can see almost 1.5 to 2 centimeter length. The lateralization of the shaft has happened. Again, confirmed by the blue line, which is inside. The trochanter is inside on the left side, whereas it is outside on the right side, indicating that shaft has got lateralized. Varus also makes the neck more horizontal and therefore functionally longer. And when the body weight is applied, the biomechanics will be totally lost, and the varus forces causes the screw to cut out superiorly. So varus should be avoided at all the cost. Friends, varus causes relative neck lengthening. How this can be shown? Here is an example, a undisplaced fracture. This is a screw which is used, say X length. Whereas when the fracture is opening superiorly, if you use a screw which is X plus A, when you compare this length of the screw, you can see that the one on the right side is a longer screw. That's the reason why I said that if you are using a screw which is more than 100 millimeter, which is means that either your fracture has gone into varus or you are distracted the fracture totally. So a care should be taken to check these things. There is recently a classification which talks about the medial cortical support. They call this as negative medial cortical support, neutral medial cortical support, and the positive medial cortical support. This article, this X-ray showed that it is a negative medial cortical support. The beak of the neck is inside the medullary canal, means it's a negative medial cortical support. Here you can see the beak of the neck is touching the distal segment of the shaft. So it's a neutral cortical support. Here the beak is outside the neck. So this is a positive cortical support. So either you should aim for a neutral cortical support with slight valgus of the head and neck. Our best will be, I normally aim for a positive cortical support with the beak of the neck outside the medullary canal. So if the beak is inside the medullary canal, it's always varus or it's a negative medial cortical support. Try to get either neutral with slight valgus of the head and neck, or try to get the beak out with valgus of the neck. So this article by Chang Zhang et al. Talks about this medial cortical support. I wish that all of you read this article and understand the principles of the reduction properly. Here is an example where you can see that the medial cortical support is normal, means the Shenton's nail is properly seen. But if you see the position of the screw is kissing the calcar in the neck, whereas it is in the central part of the head. That indicates that the proximal portion is in varus. So, though it's a neutral cortical support, neutral medial cortical support, but because of the opening at the entry site, the surgeon has shoveled the nail at the entry site, you can see that the trochanter has opened, causing the varus of the head and neck. So, if you are aiming to get a neutral cortical support, try to get the head and neck into valgus. This varus should be prevented at any cost. Otherwise, varus of the head is one of the reasons for Z effect. The loading of the hip, instead of the load, the vector of the load going along the screw to compress the fracture site, it will cause downward push of the head, that will cause varus, further varus, and one of the screw to come out, especially the inferior screw to come out and lead to Z effect. So the lag screw, another problem with this varus reduction is the cervical screw or the main cervical screw or the inferior screw gets superiorly placed, as you can see in this picture, and there will be hardly any place for the second screw to place, or even if you place them, they try to back out because of the poor purchase, or they might come out because there is hardly any bone above that part of the screw. So this is the first case which I showed. There is a varus reduction. This is again due to opening of the fracture superiorly at the entry site. This will cause the downward force, the vector force of the femoral head will be downward, or the varus force will be there. And again, here on the right side, you can see the negative cardiac support where the beak is inside the medullary canal. Again, that has caused the one of the screw to migrate out, and the Z effect has already started or set in this case. Subsequently, this patient landed in a Z effect. Another problem of varus reduction is, as I said, the screws, the vector of the force normally slides along the screws and compresses the fractures. If there is a varus reduction, the head will be loaded in this fashion. That will cause the screw to migrate superiorly and migrate outside. And gradually they cut out, as you can see on the right side, the screw has cut out from the head and neck as well as it has migrated laterally. So you should avoid varus at all the costs. On the left side, where I have marked with a circle, you can see that the beak of the proximal fragment had gone into the distal medullary canal. With a bone hook, I pulled the beak out, and that is the immediate post-operative x-ray where the Schenter's nail has been maintained very well. This was a very badly comminuted fracture. So I always advocate you get the beak out. On the right side, a tick mark is there. That is where the beak is outside, or the positive medial cortical support is the one which gives the best result. This is the same picture where the beak was inside. This is the immediate post-operative x-ray showing that the beak has been pulled out, and there is a neutral medial cortical support with the head and neck alignment proper. And in due course of time, this is after 4 months, you can see that in such a badly comminuted fracture, the fracture has healed around the nail beautifully. Another problem is the longer screw. Longer screw, one of the reason, as I said, is not releasing the traction or shoveling the nail through the fracture site without reaming properly. Let us consider now that the surgeon has done everything properly and he has not released the traction. What happens? Once the fracture collapses, when the patient starts walking, the fracture collapses. That will cause the screw to come out. Once a part of the screw is outside the bone, it has got a space to rock in and rock out, and that will cause loss of purchase of the threads of the screws in the osteoporotic head, and then one of the screw gets stuck or jammed and another screw will come out and again causes the Z effect. So always try to compact the fracture beautifully on table after releasing the fracture so that the screw head will be touching the lateral cortex. Here is an example. This is the immediate post-operative x-ray. You can see that the screw has already backed out and the beak has gone into the medullary canal, and this patient subsequently went into a Z effect because of just the screw backing out because of not releasing the traction. The same earlier x-ray, just to explain how it happens. This is the fracture. When the patient starts walking, the fracture compresses and the screw starts coming out in this fashion. The screw heads which have come out in this fashion, they are the one culprit. If the screw is touching the lateral cortex, then they don't rock in and out, and here they are free to move in and out, or especially if the patient is sleeping on that side, or even the tensor fascial latter, it gets entangled, and the movement of the tensor fascial latter itself can push in or pull out the screw, and that causes loss of purchase of the screw and the screw starts walking out. So this has to be avoided. This toggling of the screw in the nail is another cause for the Z effect, and you can see what I have been explaining has happened in this case. The superior screw has migrated inside and the inferior screw has migrated outside just because the fracture was not compacted on table or the screw was longer on table. Friends, that's the reason why I advocate all of you to compact the fractures beautifully on table. How I do that compaction? Let me show some of the pictures. This is the immediate, this, on the left down, you can see the picture of an intertrochanteric fracture. This is the on table, the picture. I'm even such a beautiful reduction. I'm trying to fix the fracture with two KOS, which are very anteriorly placed. Then I'm adapting the limb. See the entry with the guide pin I'm making. It's medial to the tip of the trochanter, almost through the piriformis fossa. Then I'm using the reamer, which is going straight down the medullary canal. And this is the immediate postoperative picture in the same patient. I have released the traction on table and compacted the fracture. And this is the left side, 21-3-16 is the immediate, after 3 months, the picture where you can see the lines, both the lines from the outermost part of the pelvis, they graze the lateralmost cortex of the greater trochanter. That indicates that the fracture has not opened up. The screw, you can see the screw heads of this fracture had not come out because I have compacted the fracture beautifully on table. There was no place for the fracture to further collapse or the screw to slide out. So you had to compress the fracture on table. How I compress the fracture? I will show a video subsequently. But before that, let me talk on some of the newer implants available in the market and how you can compress with them. Friends, these are all my personal view. It might be contradicting to what everybody understands or the market says. But I always say that there is always a commerce involved in selling this implant because the hip implants market is a very huge. Everybody wants to have his own share. That's why everybody has come out with their own implants in the market. It's a common belief that anything newer is better. The PFN came back long time back, sometime in 86, 87, the PFN came into the market, the gamma nail came into the market. And PFN sometime in 94 came into the market, and in India it came in 97, 98, and I have started using in 99. So when compared to PFN, which is more than 20 years old, almost 20 years old in India, there are PFN A2, then ZNN, Pigeon Nail, then the newer PFN, TFN, which has come in the market, advanced TFN. Everybody thinks that they are better, but I will prove what is required for us as a surgeon. Here is a PFN A2. Why I don't like it? Here is an intertrochanteric fracture in a young adult. I was using this implant. See the white arrow as well as the dark arrow. Dark arrow is at the collapsible segment of the helical blade. It's about 5 to 7 millimeter you can collapse at the end of the surgery. So when I collapse the surgery, when I collapse the helical blade, you can see that the helical blade is withdrawn because this fracture didn't read 5 millimeters of collapse also. This was so beautifully reduced on table. There was hardly any comminution. This was a young adult. So this patient did not require any collapse. So while collapsing, you can see that the screw has come back, losing the purchase it had. So I don't understand why the company has a nail or a helical blade which only allows 5 or 7 millimeters of collapse. If I require 10 millimeter collapse, how I can do it? It's not possible with this nail. If I require 15 millimeter collapse, I don't think it is possible to do it. Here I have used a PFN A2 in a subtrochanteric fracture. Why I require a collapse of the helical blade, you tell me? So I'm losing the purchase. There is no collapse happening when I compact this helical blade or lock the helical blade. So the screw comes back by 5 to 7 millimeter. The helical part comes back to the shaft by 5 to 7 millimeter, losing the purchase which had in the osteo, supposed to be having the in the osteoporotic bone. So I don't understand why this company people say that I have to compress the fracture only by 5 millimeter or 7 millimeter. I am the surgeon, I have to decide. With a PFN, I can decide how much to compact. I can compact 5 millimeter, 6 millimeter, 7 millimeter, 10 millimeter, 20 millimeter, 21 millimeter, like that. But with the helical blade, I don't have any control. Even the helical blade, they say that in an osteoporotic bone, it hardly removes the bone. See one of the pictures, this at 3 years, the screw was properly positioned. At 4 years, it started coming out. At 4 years, where I have marked round, it has removed so much of bone. You can see a dark spot. It's supposed to not remove any bone, but this nail also, or this blade also removes a lot of bone when it is being inserted. And another thing is, you don't get a sensation when you hammer the screw inside the bone. You don't get the feeling of the bone, the quality of the bone, especially in an osteoporotic fracture. Whereas when you're compacting with a PFN, when the edge touches the lateral cortex, you get a compression happening, and you know how much compression is happening, and you know the quality of the bone with which you are dealing with. Whereas in this, it's totally not possible to have any feeling feedback to the hand when we are using this system. Another newer implant in the market is Trigen nail. The inferior screw is having differential threads when compared to the superior screw. So when you pass the inferior screw, the superior through thread comes back, or the screw slides back. That will cause fracture to collapse. But in this system, you can start with 0 or 10 millimeter or 15 millimeter. If I want 5 millimeter, I am unable to use this system. If I want 7 millimeter compression, I am unable to use this system. Either it's 0, means you don't compress the fracture in a subtrochanteric fracture, or you can use 10 millimeter compression, or you can keep it at 15 millimeter and compress 15 millimeter. So the amount of compression is determined by the implant. As a surgeon, I don't have any control about the amount of compression I can do in these cases. That's one of the reasons why I don't like this Trigen nail also, though I have done a lot of demonstration of these nails. The another nail in the market is ZNN. Again, ZNN is also similar. If you put a derotational pin above the screw, the cervical screw, then you cannot put the set screw. When you cannot put the set screw, you cannot compact any of the fracture. Though you can compact the fracture on table with the instrument, but once you release that, once the instrumentation is taken out, it gets, the screw goes inside and the fracture gets distracted. So there is gamma nail, or some few other nails have got a set screw in this, which is marked with red arrow, where you can compress the fracture and lock it. Friends, if I compress the fracture as much as I want and lock it, further compression, if the fracture requires due to healing, is not possible, which is possible only with PFN. Because whatever you, the compression you achieve on table, if there is further compression is required, the screws can still slide back slightly outside. So that is the reason why I like PFN more than any of this newer implant available in the market. Unfortunately, putting two screws, the cervical screw and the derotation screw, many of we people find it difficult, and hence we become easy prey for this company which sell single screw system. Dr. Amit Rastogi from BHU Varanasi, the head of the department of Banaras Hindu University, he has done a beautiful study of comparing gamma nail, a single screw system, with PFN, a two screw system, where the gamma nail failed. 9 out of 10 gamma nail failed, and whereas only 1 out of 10 PFN failed. That is, the cycle was 50,000 cycles. They were loaded in a bone model. They did it. They did the study. So that's a beautiful, beautiful article which has appeared in Indian Journal of Orthopaedic. And that, if we know, if we read that article, we understand that two screws is always better than one. But unfortunately, as I said, we find it difficult to pass two screws, and we end up trying to put one screw and try to use newer implants which have come in the market, which are not even time tested. As you know, the helical blade system of the PFNA2 already has gone out of the market, and they have come out with the advanced TFN, where you just hammer the helical blade without getting compressed. The screw itself rotates and enters into the head and gets seated, but there is no compression available in that system again. So that is one of the reasons why I totally against all these newer implants. Why I like PFN is, if you can see that the screw heads touch the lateral cortex, and against the lateral cortex of the femur, you can beautifully compress the fracture to your satisfaction, whether it is 1 millimeter, 2 millimeter, 10 millimeter, 20 millimeter, 25 millimeter, whatever the amount the fracture begs for, that much amount of compression you can do. Even if the lateral cortex is missing, this is a very badly shattered proximal femur. This, I was doing surgery at Sancheti Hospital. Incidentally, Dr. Parag Sancheti is with us today, the president of the Maharashtra Orthopaedic Association. This January, I was demonstrating this live surgery. You can see that the lateral cortex was missing. I was using a PFN, and what I did was, I used the nail itself as the lateral cortex. Since there was no lateral cortex, I compressed the fracture against the lateral cortex. The screw head is compressed against the nail, which is the lateral cortex here. Since the lateral cortex is missing, this is immediate post-operative X-ray. You can see there was a medial void. That's why I have got excessive abduction or valgus in the head and neck. And just 4 weeks post-operatively, Dr. Atul Patil from Sancheti Hospital is the head of the trauma. He shared the picture with me. At 4 weeks, beautifully, the bone has consolidated. This is the reason why I like PFN. So, where there is no lateral cortex, you, without any worry, you can use the nail itself as a lateral cortex, not without any necessity to use a TSP or a wire or any screw or any other mechanism. You can use this nail itself as a lateral cortex and compress these fractures. Then why there are so many IM nails available in the market? If PFN is so good, as I say, why there are so many nails available? Friends, as I said earlier, there is more commerce involved. There is a court case which you can all read. This is, I downloaded from the net. This is a 2006 from USA court. This is the verdict they have given, the Smith and Nephew versus the Synthes, where they have said that the PFN, TFN and the derotation screw, all of them are patented. Nobody should use them, or they should be using similar things in the market. That is one of the reasons why we have got so many other nails. Probably once the patent period of this nail PFN goes in another few years' time, probably this PFN will come back with a great resurgence, and all the newer implants which are available in the market will have a gradual death. That's what I'm predicting. Friends, if you are able to put two screws properly in this fashion, the inferior screw should be in the inferior part of the head and neck, and also in the head as well as in the neck. Then the superior screw in the central, above the center, and the best implant available in the market at present. Because two screw surfaces have to cut through. So one screw, if it is there, it can cut the bone and it can come out. But if there are two screw surfaces, bone interference, then it is very difficult for them to cut through. This is one of my own earlier case, 2006. You can see that I have not released the traction on table and the screw has come out, and this patient, I had a Z effect. So not compressing the fracture or not releasing the traction on table is another commonest mistake we all should avoid. The same picture which I showed, again, this patient also went, had a Z effect subsequently because of the screw which is outside. Here is an example. This is a X-ray sometime in 2007 I have operated. You can see a 15 days old fracture in an elderly lady of 75 years. I have done beautiful compression, and also the medial beak is outside, or there is a positive medial contact. And after 14 months, you can see there is no collapse happening. The screw head is still touching the lateral cortex. This is what we have to achieve on table while we are doing surgery, so that the screw will not migrate and it will not start rocking, causing the Z effect. So this is the immediate post-operative X-ray, and on the picture on the right is the 14 months picture showing that the fracture has been beautifully compressed and there is no necessity for the screw. How I normally set the screw? Here I have done this attraction in the leg, and I am trying to compare the neck screw and the disc alternately. This is now I am going back to trying to compare the cervical screw. Till I am satisfied, alternately I keep compressing. I get feedback of the quality of the bone as well as compression. Now I am happy, I am stopping. this is what is the crux for the getting a good result. It's not the implant, it's the reduction and getting a good compression on the table, which is much more important in getting a better outcome rather than having a failure. Here you can see screws which are outside. The patient is pointing that the screws are hurting him on the right hip. And this patient, again, landed a Z effect, and the superior screw, you can see, has broken, and the inferior screw has walked into the head. Coming to the another problem. Many a time, when we pass the guide wire, we don't make a hole in the lateral cortex, and the guide wire is not made, the guide wire is not a stiff like drill bit. It's a more flexible, like a K wire. So they are not able to drill the lateral cortex and they go haywire. Either they go superiorly or inferiorly in the hole also, or it might go above or below the nail also. Sometimes I have faced those problems also. So always make a hole in the lateral cortex before you pass the guide wire. And many a time the nail and the teeth upset the position of the guide wire in the lateral picture. If you can see the neck properly anteriorly as well as posteriorly, that indicate that your neck screws or the guide wires are obstructed by the nail. And if you want to see the screw, either you can rotate the C-arm, but don't rotate the neck or the jig. Many a time, I find that our colleagues or friends, they rotate the jig. Here you can see the C-arm has been rotated, and in the same picture, the same patient, the front's guide wire is actually the K wire which is fixing the fracture, and two K wires which are behind are the guide wires in the head and neck for the screw. Here you can see there is slight bending of the guide wire because the surgeon, instead of rotating the C-arm, has rotated the jig. He has just pushed the jig away and is trying to see the head and neck. That will cause bending of the guide wire, and sometimes the guide wire can break also. That's why you should never turn the jig to see the head and neck guide wire properly. If you have passed the antiversion guide wire, then you can, along with the antiversion guide wire, you can rotate the jig. So that the antiversion guide wire has a purchase in the head and neck. So you are turning the head and neck as well as the jig simultaneously. That can be done as in this fashion. So the next problem is guide wire breakage. Guide wire breakage is very, very common because especially in the loaner set, they don't change the guide wires. I normally prescribe two guide wires along with the implant to all my patients, and at the slightest hint of bending or not properly drilling the guide wire, I just bend them, cut them and throw them in the dustbin, because they are not very costly. Because if you have a problem and if the guide wire break like this, then you have to spend a lot of time in the OT unnecessarily removing it. While removing the guide wire, it's easy during the surgery itself rather than retaining it and trying to retain later, and you have to explain to the patient also that there is a broken guide wire. So all those problems comes. So always try to keep a basket, the arthroscope basket or the disc punch. Don't use a straight artery forceps because the fulcrum is away and it is very difficult to open and catch them. And with a basket of arthroscope, you can, or a disc punch, you can pass the disc punch to the hole in the nail itself, and you can open and you can grab the guide wire and pull it out. Whereas on the left side, you can see that the straight artery forceps, it's very difficult to open within the nail. So it's always better to keep this instrument handy. This is the picture demonstrating the same, a guide wire broken being tried to be removed by a disc punch. Here is an X-ray shared by on India by one of my friends, where he had a lot of problem in drilling. And he said that he removed the, he could not drill the guide neck screw properly over the guide wire. So he sent this picture on the IndiaOrth. You can see here that the nail has been drilled. What happens is when you start the drilling, the guide wire has to be in the center of the hole, the oblong hole for the nail. Sometimes the assistant pushes the nail inside, or if you have inserted the nail through a small keyhole incision, the muscle pushes the nail out. So the guide wire will be eccentrically placed in the hole in the nail. So that is one of the cause for this. So always, always see the position of the guide wire before you start drilling with a step cut drill which comes for the screw. As I said earlier, always use the awl before you pass the guide wire. There's a problem we normally face is the inferior guide wire bends superiorly and the superior guide wire bends inferiorly. This is due to a trabecular pattern, the least resistance area the guide wire passes. Even if you change this guide wire many times, it will keep on going in the same direction. So what you have to do is till the position, the time where the guide wire is straight, you drill for the step cut drill bit, then take out the guide wire, drill this cut drill bit by another millimeter or another say 1 centimeter, then you pass the guide wire again and you can pass the screw subsequently. This is another instrument is looking like a cobra hood which can depress the guide wire is also useful. Here you can see this is one of the Halifax nail I was doing. This instrument is useful in keeping the guide wire depressed. It is preventing the guide wire to go above, and this instrument is very, very useful. Always use hand instrument rather than power instrument. So if you are drilling with a power instrument, you will not know the resistance. If it is a drill, the guide wire is not properly positioned, the resistance is not properly felt by. If you are using hand instrument, that in my own case, you can see that the guide wire on the screw going properly. Then I the guide wire was not straight, and I immediately took out guide wire, and it was because the position in the lateral picture was not proper. I had eccentrically place the guide wire and I tried to drill that. Because I was using a hand instrument, I could recognize and pull this out. Otherwise, probably if I was using a powered instrument, this would have been a disaster. The screw guide wire removal would have been another major surgery in this case. So in osteoporotic fracture, I don't think we require powered system. Hand drill and T-handle which comes with the set is more than sufficient to drill this drill step cut drill bits, as well as the reaming is whatever is required. Hand reamers are more than sufficient. Coming to some problems with the subtrochanteric fracture, I think we are already too late. I'll try to finish in another 5-10 minutes. Especially obese and narrow middle leg canal, and this patient, the nailing has been done. You can see the nailing should have gone in the direction where the white line is there. But unfortunately, abduction, flexion, deformity is very, very common. And varus is also another problem which is very, very common in these cases. This is all due to guide wire. We try to enter the pass the guide wire in the medial part of the proximal canal, and that will lead to varus at the of the proximal fragment and subsequent problem. Here is a very hefty lady. Again, a high subtrochanteric fracture. Entry was made with the nail, but unfortunately it hit the medial cortex and there was a iatrogenic fracture of the medial wall, and subsequently it had to be treated with a 95 degree Richards plate. When you do a subtrochanteric fracture, keep the guide wire parallel to the lateral cortex in AP and parallel to the anterior cortex in lateral. Then only open the medial canal with the reamer which comes with the set. Don't go medially. If they go medially, then the fragment, proximal fragment will always go into varus. So if the keeping the nail parallel to the lateral cortex is the crux of this subtrochanteric fracture. We always say the red line is for the intertrochanteric fracture and the green line for the subtrochanteric fracture. That is from the medial to the tip of the trochanter. But for me, it's from the piriformis fossa, which is much more common. Even if you go medial to the tip of the trochanter, many a time we slip into the piriformis fossa. There is no harm in taking the entry from the piriformis fossa. This is another instrument, a curved awl, which is very, very useful, keeping your guide wire parallel to the lateral cortex. Proximal into varus is one of the commonest problems with the subtrochanteric fracture that is due to huge perineal post. I try to use a smaller perineal post against the opposite side ischial tuberosity, and you pass a Steenman pin as a joystick. Assistant adducts and internally rotates, then I'll pass the nail from the top, and this is how I use the Steenman pen in the proximal fragment as a joystick to adduct and internally rotate so that the teardrop in the piriformis fossa can be seen. This is a very high subtrochanteric fracture, again with a Steenman pin adduction, entry from the piriformis fossa, reaming parallel to the lateral cortex, and passing the nail, and this is the final X-ray on table. So beautiful reduction can be obtained. See that the nail is in the lateral cortex. Another demonstration is done in Latur. Again, you can see that the nail is in the lateral part of the proximal canal. This is what happens if you take the tip of the trochanter, the nail will hit me and it can cause osteogenic fracture. A short nail and a thinner nail can go into the distal medullary canal, but a thicker nail will cause iatrogenic fracture. This was a high subprochanteric fracture. You can see that the tip of the trochanter entry and the entry has been done. Reaming has been done beautifully. While the nail was being passed, you can see that there is an iatrogenic fracture happening and a butterfly fragment coming out, and that had to be treated with a 25 centimeter PFN. So the entry for this nail, I always consider it as piriformis fossa instead of taking a tip of the trochanter. If you take the tip of the trochanter entry, you can see that the nail, the distal part of the nail is not in the medullary canal, but if you take the proximally, the entry for the piriformis fossa, the nail can superimposed over the bone beautifully without any problem. Also see the position of the cervical screw. The where the piriformis entry is taken, the neck screw position is inferior in the neck as well as in the head, whereas on the right, where the tip of the trochanter entry is taken, the cervical screw, which is kissing the calcar, has already gone in the center of the head. Another problem is a longer PFN, if you are using, then it will hit the medial cortex. If you take the tip of the trochanter entry, unnecessarily you have to over-rim it. Or if you take the piriformis entry, you can see that beautifully it can enter into the medullary canal without any problem. This article, which talks about injury to medial circumflex if entry is more than 30 meter, is the one with which we are worried. But friends, not seen any problem of AVN by taking entry with the 15 or 16 millimeter reamer with PFN. So I boldly advocate you to use the same technique, and you can use for subtrochanteric fracture or even intertrochanteric fracture, the white line or the Shivshankar's entry or the piriformis entry in this fracture. Here is a fracture shaft femur in the proximal third, a piriformis entry taken. See the position of the screw, which are beautifully placed. Another shaft taken, again a piriformis entry is taken, beautifully positioned of the screws, and the reduction you can see. This is a fracture, again operated last year, 2 years back, 2016 at the Sancheti Hospital during the Pune trauma course. You can see by taking a piriformis fossa entry, I am able to pass a 16 millimeter thick nail in such a narrow medullary canal. So that's the advantage of taking a piriformis fossa entry, which is directly in line with the medullary canal. So you can pass a thicker nail without compromising on the thinness of the nail. Otherwise, if from the tip of the trochanter, probably I have to use a 8 or 9 millimeter size nail instead of using 11 millimeter size nail. Position of the screw is also very, very important. The cervical screw should be either in the center or slightly inferior. I like to be as inferior possible, that's fine. Then if the only disadvantage of taking a piriformis entry is some of our Indian nails becomes too proud, and the patient might complain of problem in the neck, or that might cause, especially in a shorter neck ladies, that will cause some problem while sitting cross-legged. So I have recently designed a nail which is shorter by 15 millimeter, which can be used on any of your system which are you already using. So without changing the jig, it's only an additional conical bolt and a 15 millimeter washer, and the newer nail which is 15 millimeter shorter proximally can be used. So at the end of the surgery, we just take out this washer and that's all. So we apply the washer and make a regular size nail, and after the surgery, this washer which is there 15 millimeter size is removed. You can see that the nail is shorter by 15 millimeter and it is fitting perfectly. Especially in central India, this nail is required because the ladies there are the sickle cell disease is one of the reason why they have got proximal part of the femur very short, and this is being used extensively in that part. I had the opportunity to use only in few cases, though I have done this modification. And see that the nail is above the entry site. Otherwise, again, it will rock. the fixation within the entry bone is also very, very important. That's very, very important. Otherwise, the rocking of the nail will cause loss of purchase. Friends, to conclude, not releasing the traction before distal locking, distraction, not using awl for distal locking, missing a locking hole. The list is never ending. There are so many things I can keep on talking, but I have already overshot the time by almost 30 minutes. So I want to conclude. So always operate without skipping any steps. Each and every step time, it is very important. Recently, I did a case, a high subtrochanteric fracture. You can see with a Steenman pin, I asked the assistant to adduct, made an entry from the piriformis fossa, going parallel to the lateral cortex, guide wire is passed, superior screw is passed first, inferior screw is passed second, then fracture, traction is released, compaction of the fracture done, then distal locking done. So each and every case, if you follow this systematically, then there shouldn't be any problem. And the patient, this is the immediate postoperative X-ray, which is so beautiful. And the patient, he will decide. Normally, he will be putting out 50% of the weight, but as the pin comes, loading more than that. So, I would like to conclude, as Dr. Parag Sancheti said, once again, to invite you all from 1st to 4th November to JW Marriott in Pune for the 35th annual conference of the Maharashtra Orthopaedic Association, that the MOA Con. We have 9 pre-conference workshops, and we have 2 orations and jam-packed program, and also spouses program, so many entertainment program, everything has been planned. These are some of the executive members and the organizing committee which are working hard for this conference. I would like to thank mention again the president, Dr. Parag Sancheti, the vice president, Dr. Yashwant Gade from Aurangabad, and the treasurer, secretary cum treasurer, Dr. Parag Prakash Sigedar from Jalna, along with all the executive members, as well as the webinar in charge, Dr. Ashok Shyam. You can register this for this conference online. You can visit www.moacon2018pune.com. Welcome to Pune for this conference. I thank you very much. And if there are any questions, Ashok Shyam will be asking me. I am ready to answer. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. I think that was a really extensive. Yes, sir.
Are there any questions?
I think this was a really extensive webinar. I can hear you. Hello? Just a minute, sir.
No voice. Yeah. No.
Hello?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Yes, any questions? Yeah.
So I think this was a really extensive webinar, and you covered most of the queries that everybody will have in their minds. There was one query by Dr. Lakshya Rathod about reduction maneuvers in these fractures.
Yes.
So he is asking about which is the standard method and are there any easy practical ones.
See, the standard method is keep the patient on an orthopedic table, abduct, external rotate, then give traction, adduct in the internal rotate. That majority of the cases, fracture gets reduced. But I try to use a Steenman pin because even though you get a reduction, you have to get 100% reduction. Even if the neck is slightly displaced anteriorly or posteriorly, the loss of contact is too much because anteriorly there is 25% loss and posteriorly another 25% loss means there is 50% loss of contact. So I try to insert a Steenman pin into the fracture site and I normally reduce them percutaneously. Yeah.
Right.
And that video is also there on YouTube. Yeah. Okay. In the last webinar I have shown that video. That's why I don't want to show it again. I didn't show that again. Yeah.
So, I think a lot of questions will pour in tomorrow or day after.
Yeah.
And we have very less time for interventions at this point of time.
I would like to ask you, since you do a lot of research, whether I was too much critical saying that the newer implant was our bad PFN. I mic to you, Ashok. Because I explained why I like PFN, because I can compress, I can use it as a lateral wall, I feel the compression happening with my finger. All those explanations I have given, but whether I was too critical in saying that the newer implants were bad, because I do like them, because the system is really good. Many a time I use them still, because passing a single screw saves almost 10 to 15 minutes for me also.
Right.
Yeah. What is your take on this?
I think from research point of view, a lot of these new implants are lacking the basic research.
Yeah.
Correct. In terms of biomechanics, in terms of virtual analysis, and in terms of even animal experimentation. So most of the things have just been modified from a primary source. And like you said, the primary implant is under copyright. So the modifications are more to overcome the patent rather than to add any additional benefits as such.
Yeah, that's. I think you are right.
Yeah. So I thank you, sir. And I believe there are more than 1,000 people who have joined us this evening. And yes. I hope everybody has benefited from it. Thank you very much, sir. We'll see you soon again.
Thank you very much. Have a nice day. Thank you.